I don't know about you, but I've really been trying to just hear from God, like, Lord, what's the word that you have for me on this season? Where are you sending me? Where are you kind of guiding me? And I found, talking to one of my friends on this week, a passage of scripture that I traditionally would not preach from. I traditionally wouldn't lean on this type of text, but God gave it to me to preach it to y'all, so y'all just rock with me. Amen, somebody? So if you have your Bibles, and thank you, Dave, for my amen corner, Daniel, the third chapter and the 25th verse. Daniel, the third chapter and the 25th verse. And it reads, and you're hearing this on the screens for you, it says, look, Nebuchadnezzar shouted, I see four men. If you're not too mean, will you look at somebody to your right or to your left and tell them, seeing is believing. I want you to say it like you really feel it. Say, seeing is believing. There are spaces and places in our faith where we encourage one another to trust where we can't trace, right? To really believe what we can't really see. It's like I'm trusting God to move and I don't know where it's going to come from. I'm trusting God to open a door and I'm not exactly sure where the open door is going to be found. But I want to encourage you, my brothers and my sisters, that there are some areas in your life where seeing is believing. We all have a homegirl who has been in a relationship, or we know a man who's been in a relationship, and it seems like they just keep getting cheated on and lied to, and they take the person back. And then they get cheated on and lied to again, and they take the person back, and they get cheated on and lied to again, and they come to your house, and you're like, why don't you leave Pookie alone? And they tell you, well, he told me he's going to do right this time. And it's like, baby, seeing is believing, right? One of my favorite shows, I'm kind of crazy. I watch all type of TV shows, so you'll hear me talk about a lot of television. It's called Ancient Aliens. Some of y'all have seen this show. It comes on the History Channel, and I like it because it talks about all these different things in world history and these phenomena that people don't have an answer for. And it's this guy with this quirky hair, and he'll always say, maybe Noah's Ark was an alien. And I'm like, okay, this dude is crazy. And he'll say, well, I've seen an alien and seeing is believing. And I'm like, yeah, bro, I'm not with you. And I ain't never seen one, so I can't get with you on that, right? I know we have some parents in the room. Again, I have a three-year-old and a two-month-old. And not everybody's just gonna watch my kids one. Not everybody, my kids is not going to everybody's house because I have to first observe, how are you with kids? Do I kind of discern that you don't have, some ways that I can't trust, that my son may come back messed up because I let him go to your house? So I can't just send my kids over there. I got to wait a little bit because seeing is believing. I want to use that idea as sort of a thematic thrust for the next few minutes, that seeing is believing. I told you all, Daniel 3 is not normally a text I would teach from, because if you've been at church for 5 minutes at all, this is kind of Sunday school 101. These type of stories, Daniel and the lion's den, Noah's ark, Jonah in the belly of a beast. There's stories that we teach our children because they're easy to remember, like the three little pigs. So when I first preached my first sermon as an adult young man in 2010, the story I preached out of was this. And the reason I preached it, Coyette, is because I didn't know my Bible like that. So I tend to stay away from these scriptures, but I believe on today that God is going to lift some things that will bless you. So y'all know me, I first have to give you some context so you can respect the content. We find in Daniel, the book of Daniel, these four Jewish young men. Their names are Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, and Belteshazzar. You all have never heard the name Belteshazzar. That's Daniel. That's what they call Daniel. Their real names are Daniel, Ananiah, Azariah, and Mishael. Daniel, Ananiah, Azariah, and Mishael are Jewish young men. And a king named Nebuchadnezzar goes to where they live. He conquers the city and he turns them into slaves. Are you still here? So these four young men become slaves. They're working in King Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom, but they refuse to eat the food that those people eat. They say, we may be slaves, but our God has told us to eat this way. We refuse to do what y'all do. They're working in the kingdom and God begins to elevate them. King Nebuchadnezzar has this dream of this huge statue. It's gold, it's bronze, it's silver, and none of his magicians can interpret the dream. So Daniel says, God, give me the interpretation because we don't like being slaves. We want favor with the king. He tells the king, God has given me an interpretation. And he looks at Daniel and says, you are a slave. I'm about to make you a senator.
He says, you are a slave, but I'm about to get you in a position of leadership. You are a cold-blooded brother. And Daniel said, bros, before anybody else, take my brothers with me. So these four men, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, go from being slaves to literally senators. That they go from being slaves. This is Daniel chapter 1 and Daniel chapter 2. That's your homework. Read that when you get home. Daniel chapter 1 and Daniel chapter 2. They go from slaves to senators. These young men, city is captured. They become slaves. Their names are Daniel, Azariah, Hananiah, and Mishael. But in this new kingdom, they give them new names, the names you know them by, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. As I was reading that, what stuck out to me in the text is sometimes we have to remember what God calls us. They ended up in this kingdom, and they were being called everything else except their God-given name. And it's interesting to me because sometimes we'll get in situations in our life, Dave, and people will look at our circumstance, and based on our circumstance, they'll say we're struggling. And while they're calling us struggling, God calls us sustained. People will look at our circumstance and they'll say, based on your circumstance, you got some real problems. And they'll call us a person with problems, but God will call us a person with peace. And you have to make sure you don't identify by what people call you, but you identify with how God calls you. So these men, they rejected those slave names. They said, we're not eating how y'all eat. We're interpreting dreams. God is using us in a very real way. They get promoted from slavery to senators. And as we tiptoe towards our text, we find ourselves in Daniel, the third chapter and the first verse. And Daniel, the third chapter and the first verse, it says, King Nebuchadnezzar made a gold statue 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide. And he set up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Did I tell you all that King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream? Did I tell you all that his dream was of this gold and bronze and silver statue, and David interpreted his dream? The interpretation that David gave him of this dream was that God was about to do something mighty in God's kingdom. His interpretation of this dream was God was about to do something mighty in God's kingdom. And the text lets us know in Daniel 3:1 that Nebuchadnezzar made a gold statue 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide. I want to show you this picture. You can put it up on the screens for me. The statue on the left, or the monument on the left, is representative. The statue on the right, or the monument on the right, is representative of the statue that the king had in his dream, King Nebuchadnezzar. It was a gold, silver, and bronze statue. The statue on the left is representative of the statue that Nebuchadnezzar built. One statue represented a dream that God had given him about God building his kingdom. The other statue, Nebuchadnezzar woke up and built a statue unto himself, talking about the greatness of his own kingdom. I hope you all are with me. He had a dream about the greatness of God's kingdom. It was a statue, a monument that represented God's kingdom, but he woke up and built a statue, a monument to himself that represented his kingdom. Here's my first point. If you're taking notes, write this down. If you're not taking notes, write this down. Throw it up on the screen for me, Nate. How do people see your monuments? Nebuchadnezzar was given a dream about a monument to God's kingdom. And he woke up and built a monument to his own kingdom. He had a dream that was communicating to him about the glory and honor of God. And he built a monument that was supposed to show how great and grand he was. Well, what's your point, Brother Preacher? I'm glad you asked. Many of us, God gave you a dream. He told you you're going to be the first person in your family who doesn't have kids with Lottie Dottie and everybody. He told you you're going to be the first person in your family who gets a degree and is financially stable. He told you you're going to be the first person in your family that's an entrepreneur. You're not ghetto. You're not in generational crazy. You were going to turn some things around in your family. You had this dream, and now you find yourself finally realizing some of the stuff that God has done in your life. It's shown up. It's manifested. But when people look at it, do they see a monument to God or do they see a monument to you? He gave Nebuchadnezzar a dream of a monument. It was a dream that represented the power of God's kingdom. But he woke up and built a statue to show the power of his. And I want to ask you, when people look at your monuments, when they look at these monumental moments in your life, when they go in the office and say, girl, you got a master's? Girl, you went to APU? Is it like, yeah, I did that? Or is it God is good? Do you remember that you didn't know how you was gonna pay financial aid? Do you remember you was in that office with tears in your eyes and all of a sudden you did your thing. Let's not forget, this needs to be a monument to God and not a monument to you. Too many of us, when God moves in our life, well, when God opens a door, things that we prayed about, God finally does it, and it ends up, instead of being a monument to him, it is a monument to us. Can I get naked so y'all can take y'all clothes off too? Children's Church is next door, amen? This church decided to close its doors in November of 2019. We closed our doors February of 2019, or excuse me, 2020. I called it early, and people thought I was crazy, and then 2 weeks later, everybody church shut down. And then in the fall, we decided to reopen because it seemed as if the numbers were going down. The numbers started spiking back up. I was praying. God dealt with me, and I said, you know what? I think we need to close our doors again. And we already talked about it. Y'all know the story. We decided to move away from our building. I'm sitting here saying to myself, okay, God, how are you going to open the door? How are you going to open the door? And God blessed us and opened the building. This is something interesting. In that process, I took some of our leaders to the Dream Center. You guys heard of the Dream Center before? The Dream Center is this place in Los Angeles, California. It's like a 100-acre property, a hospital's on it. They turned it into a facility for transitional living, people who are in recovery from drugs and alcohol. They take care of communities. They adopt a block. I took some of our leaders to the Dream Center so we can open our eyes to what great ministry looks like. And one of the leaders from the Dream Center sat down at the table, and we began to talk to him about the process and the transition we're in. And he said, I want to ask you guys something. These leaders, some of them are in the room. They were sitting at the table. He says, what do you all like about your church? And everybody at the table said, you know what? I really like Pastor Lance. He be doing his thing. Somebody else said, Pastor Lance be killing, boy. That boy be preaching, boy. They said, you know, Pastor Lance. And I'm telling you, I was at the table like, ooh-wee, like, yes, like, give it to me, like, uh-huh. And then I began to think, and it hit me, if the only thing you get when you come to Character Church is how much you like Pastor Lance, I'm building a monument to myself. I'm not building a monument to God. And many of us, do we pause and reflect and ask ourselves, the things I'm doing right now, the things I'm working on, the things I'm building, are these monuments to me? Maybe it's not you, but is it a monument to your wife? Is this a monument to your kids? Or is it a monument to him? Well, we have to get to a place where we're not like King Nebuchadnezzar, where everything we do is about me, my four, and no more. But even when God moves and opens doors in your life, it is a monument to him. The text says that King Nebuchadnezzar built a monument, and we pick up in Daniel the third chapter and the fourth verse. Daniel the third chapter and the fourth verse. It says, then a herald shouted, people of all races and nations and languages, listen to the king's command. When you hear the sound of a horn, a flute, and all this other music, bow to the ground to worship King Nebuchadnezzar's gold statue. The sixth verse says, anyone who refuses to obey will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace. So we read the story and skip past it, but they literally said they was going to put them in an oven. Right? He says, if you don't bow, we're going to put you in a blazing furnace. You know, we just, they was in the fire. No, they were going to be put in a stove. And I'm thinking to myself, King Nebby, you have to throw them in a stove? Like, they couldn't just go to the hole for a few weeks? Like, they couldn't just get locked up? You won't let me out? Like, a stove, right? And this is how my mind works. As I was studying this on this week, I began to think about one of my favorite TV shows. Some of y'all have watched it. It's called Vikings, right? Y'all seen this show Vikings. Some of y'all have. And it's about a man named Ragnar and all his sons and his homeboy Floki. It's a real good show. If you haven't watched it, check it out. It's good. Who can you just show me your hand? Make me feel like I'm not alone. Who in here seen Vikings? Just two or three of y'all. It's okay. Y'all gonna catch it. The other ones, y'all gotta watch it. Amen, somebody. But when Ragnar, spoiler alert, one of the stars of the show was about to die, and I got a picture of it, they put him in this cage. And I was watching the show like, oh my goodness, they got Ragnar in this cage. And all these hundreds of people were around watching Ragnar in this cage. And they were preparing to drop him into a pit of snakes to kill him. And I'm like, they not going to do, this is Ragnar, right? I'm like, the whole show about him, how they going to kill him? And Ashton, they dropped him in this cage in front of hundreds of people and they killed him. And I'm thinking to myself, how did the world just switch one day and we stop doing this, right? We just stop putting people in furnaces. We stop dropping them in pits of snakes. And I was studying on this week. I was reading a book about the history of the church throughout the world. And what I learned, they killed people. Leaders of nations and countries and kings killed people because their society was not as structured as ours. They didn't have the police and social ordinances and things like that we had to keep things in place. So what they did, they had an army, but the army wasn't going to your house when you had a domestic dispute, right? So what they did, if you committed a crime, they felt threatened by what you did. They didn't want anybody else doing it. They would make an example out of you. They said, instead of us having a huge police department, we just gonna set you on fire. And ain't nobody else gonna do that. Instead of us, you know, having 911, no, we have snakes in pits and cages. So Nebuchadnezzar said, if you do not bow, we're gonna make an example. It's not just an appropriate punishment for you, but it's a lesson for them. That you must bow to me or you will experience one of the most traumatic deaths that anybody could experience. I want you to see how serious what this king was saying. He said, I'm going to teach the whole nation a lesson if you do not bow. Somebody better find themselves bowing or burning. King Nebi was crazy. He said, bow or burn. And the third verse, the eighth verse of the third chapter of Daniel, watch this. It says, some astrologers who knew the punishment, they went to the king and became informants. They went to the king and put their name on some paperwork. Y'all watch verse 48. They went to the king. They had a cheeseburger and a Coke. And they told the king, there's some Jews, that there are some Jews who are not going to listen. There are some Jews, and I'm asking myself, why did they tell on the Jews, Dave? Well, why did they go to these Jews and say they are not going to bow? Why did they tell the king that these Jews were not going to bow? And I can answer you when you look at their decision making. They showed up as slaves. They honor God with their diet. It's in Daniel 1. They showed up as slaves, they learned the ways of the Babylonians, but they never let go of their ways. They show up in Daniel chapter 2, they're not up here trying to do magic tricks and throwing dust around. They're praying, saying, Lord, speak to us for an interpretation. All throughout Daniel 1 and Daniel 2, their works showed what they believed. All throughout Daniel 1 and Daniel 2, their works were proof we are who we say we are. So no matter how bad the challenge, no matter how harsh the punishment, our works prove that we're going to trust God. When you look back at our track record proves we are God's people. Here is my next point. I want to push you on this Sunday. How do people see your works? When they talk about you in the community, when they talk about you in the neighborhood, here's another one. When they talk about you in your family, how do people see your works? It's cute to come to church and look saved, sanctified, and Kentucky fried. But some people get in the car and go home with you. How do they see your works? A lot of us, we have a 9-to-5. Do your coworkers even know that you love Jesus? I know it's okay to laugh and joke about love and hip hop or whatever show you like and the music that you like and sing the songs that you like. But when y'all go to lunch, do they ever hear some Kirk Franklin in your car? Well, what do people see when they see your works? I'm not saying that you gotta be perfect and have everything together. I don't have everything together. But people should be able to smell a little bit of works on you. They should be able to stumble into something in your life that shows that you love God. How do people see your works? This is a question that I really want you to wrestle with on this week. What do people see when they see me? See, there's a story of a young man, and I have a picture of it, Nate, who used to sneak out of his bedroom every night. He would climb down a tree, sneak out of his bedroom, and go see his girlfriend every single night. Every night, he would climb out of his window, climb down a tree, and go see his girlfriend every single night. His dad woke up one morning. He said, son, I'm going to cut this tree down. He said, Daddy, what you mean you're going to cut the tree down? He said, well, you know what? The tree is not producing any fruit. So I'm gonna cut the tree down. The son woke up the next morning, early in the morning, went to the grocery store, bought a crate of lemons. He tied the lemons to the barren branches of the tree. He went to school, came home, and the tree was gone. He said, Daddy, why did you cut the tree down? You didn't see all the lemons that grew in the tree? It was full of lemons. Why did you cut the tree down? And the daddy said, son, it's an apple tree. Scripture says, put the scripture up there quickly for me, Nate. Put the scripture up there quickly. In Matthew, the 7th chapter and the 16th verse, it says, you will know a tree by the fruit it bears. And many of us think we're walking around with lemons, but really you're showing some apples. Many of us think that we're walking around as a loving, giving, caring, appreciative, patient person. You think you show the fruits of the Spirit, but you're showing the fruits of the devil. You got an attitude, you're mean, you're irritable. And I want you to ask yourself on today, how do people see your works? You may fool some people for a little while, but you can't fool people forever. You may fool people for a minute. You're on Facebook in love and happily married, but how come when you come to church, you don't ever sit by your spouse? How come every weekend is a ladies' night? But you love, and you in love on Facebook, but when I'm in your face, it feels different. You got to ask yourself, what is my fruit? What do people see when they see my work? What does my work say about me? Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, and Daniel were known as men of God because of their works. And when it came for them to go through another trial, these other leaders said, we already know they're going to mess up. Let's go tell the king. Daniel, the third chapter in the 13th verse. Are y'all enjoying this on today? Daniel, the third chapter in the 13th verse. It says, furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king. Nate, can you take me to the 16th verse? I want to go quickly here. Let's cut across the grass. It says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we're thrown into this fiery furnace, if you throw us into the oven, if you kill us in a way that everyone else will be scared by seeing how you killed us, the God we serve is able to deliver us. And he will deliver us from your hand. The 18th verse says, but even if he doesn't, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the monument that you have set up to yourself. Leave that on the screen for me for just a brief moment. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Notice the purposeful pause. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Who is it in the text right here? We see Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But when the other leaders went to the king on verse 48 and began snitching, they said, the Jews will not listen. They went to the king and said, the Jews will not listen. But the ones that are brought before the king are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Why is it that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are brought to the king? They're brought to the king because we know their works. They are men of God. They're not going to bow, and that's why Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are brought to the king. Don't clap too early because you're going to miss your shout. There's somebody missing. His name is Daniel. Yeah. I'm asking myself, why is it that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, because of their works, have found themselves about to go into a fiery furnace? And I begin to remember in Daniel, the second chapter, it's your homework, read it when you get home. Daniel interpreted the king's dream. Daniel was doing the work of the Lord by interpreting dreams. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were doing the work of the Lord by honoring how God told them to live. Is it possible that sometimes your works can get you into the fire, but sometimes your works can keep you out of the fire? Many of us think, I'm living for God so he can get me out, but also living for God keeps you from. And you got to get to a place in your life. See, we didn't even realize Daniel was missing. You read this your whole life, and you was like, you just skipped over Daniel. The book is called the Book of Daniel, and y'all just forgot Daniel existed in it, right? And I'm like, where did Daniel go? Well, maybe Daniel was kept from this because his works gave him favor with the king. And you don't realize the way that you live will give you favor with people who have power. The way that you live, your supervisor is crazy, but watch how you just keep being a godly example to him. Watch how you just keep being loving even though they a trip. You like, I'm here before everybody else is 5 minutes late. I'm 5 minutes early, but you got me in the staff meeting. But you just keep being godly. Yeah. Keep loving it. Watch how when other people get written up, your supervisor call you in like, girl, we good. Let's go to Chick-fil-A. You have to have the mindset, I'm going to clock in and do the work and trust God with the rest. I'm going to clock in, be who God called me to be, go where God called me to go, and I am going to trust God with the rest. So somebody here, your word for this week needs to be, Lord, if it's your will, I'm just going to do it. If it's your will, I'm just going to show up where you want me to show up. I'm going to go where you want me to go, and I'm going to trust you with the rest. I don't know if they're going to call me in this or if you're going to keep me out of it, but I'm going to keep being who I need to be. So many of us have looked at people who took PPP loans They were scamming EBT and EDD and all the other parts of the alphabet. And you're like, you know what, Lord? I'm just going to keep doing the work you told me to do. I'm going to just keep being who you called me to be. Yes, I probably could say I got a little LLC. I know business. I can set it up. But no, I'm going to just be honest. And watch when your integrity speaks, your work speaks, how God blesses you, how God honors you because you honored him. Okay, y'all know the story. It's the three Hebrew boys. They're thrown in the fire. They come out of the fire, and we find ourselves in Daniel, the third chapter, and the 28th verse. Daniel, the third chapter, and the 28th verse. It says, then Nebuchadnezzar said, praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He says, praise be the God. Y'all made it out the fire. Praise be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. One thing about me, if I was not a pastor, a part of me would have went into probably something in the arts. I'd been working on like films or something. This is what I would have done. It's like I'd either been into like something with journalism and media or like just act. This is what I love. My wife the other day was like, you know how to edit all this type of stuff? I was like, yeah, girl, I'll be doing my thing, right? And there's something in film that's called Chekhov's gun. And you can put it up on the screen. I want them to be able to see what this is if they want to look into it. It's a cinema trope. It's called Chekhov's gun. And what this is this concept of a plant and a payoff. It's a plant. Y'all see it in movies all the time. It's a plant and a payoff. They plant something early in the movie and it pays off at the end. Right, the best example, I don't know why I thought of this movie, but y'all seen the movie The Fifth Element, right? Y'all seen this movie before with Chris Tucker? In The Fifth Element, the star of the film, he smokes cigarettes. So at the beginning of the film, he pulls out a match, he lights the match and smokes a cigarette. It's just a small part of the film. And then he has one match left in his matchbox. He shows it real quick. He puts it in his pocket. The rest of the film, you don't think nothing about no cigarettes. The end of the film, they have to get four elements to ignite. The first one is wind, they blow, it ignites. The second one is dust, they pick up some dirt, it ignites. The next one is water, they wipe sweat, and it ignites. And Chris Tucker is sitting there saying, I don't know how we gonna light this element, right? And they're going crazy, and they're trying to figure out what they're gonna do. And Bruce Willis reaches in his pocket, and you remember at the beginning of the movie, he was smoking cigarettes. And here he is with that one match left, and he lights that element, and they save the day. It's a plant, and it's a payoff. Some of y'all who have never seen this movie from my 45 and older, you remember the movie Jaws, when the dude was fumbling and bumbling on the boat, and then that little thing fell off, and it was like, be careful, it's explosive. And at the end of Jaws, he pulled a gun out, and he shoots that very explosive that almost exploded at the beginning of the film. It's the plant. And okay, some of y'all are like, I never seen that. I was born in the 1980s, not the 1970s. Okay, y'all seen Austin Powers when he gets the toothpaste and all that, and he's like, what is this? And at the end of the movie, he fights a dude. Okay, y'all don't know what I'm talking about. It's a plant and a payoff. When we look at the text, it's planted in our minds that they honor God with everything they do. They honor God with their diet. They honor God with their studies. Everybody else is trying to interpret a dream by doing magic, and they throwing dust. It's like Remember the Times music video. They're trying to interpret this dream with all these different ways, and they say, Lord, give us an interpretation. They honor God with the king's request. Their entire lives are rooted in honoring God by their choices. That's the plant, and the payoff is they make it out of the fire. And everybody is looking at them saying, oh my goodness, we've watched your entire life. We've seen you all when you first became slaves and you honored God and became senators. And we saw when you interpreted a dream, and we saw when you honored God, you could have bowed. You could have conveniently just tied your shoe and everybody was bowing, but you honored God. Oh my gosh, and the payoff is here. You have made it. Can you all imagine, let's be real, how encouraged you would be. Somebody honors God and God just brings them through a fire. Can you imagine, even if you were questioning your faith, if you like, I'm done with church, I'm done with God, I would be in there shouting, oh my God, I would be in there going crazy. You done brought them through the fire. This is amazing. Can you imagine how they felt? This is their story. Their story is we honor God, we went through the fire, we made it out. That's their story. We honor God, we went through the fire. Everyone saw their story. This is a testimony. Revelations, the 12th chapter, the 11th verse. It's not on the screens. It says, we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the words of their testimony. This is their testimony. I'm encouraged to overcome because you came out the fire. Your story is you were faithful and God was faithful. This is their story. People who they didn't preach a sermon, please hear me. They didn't tell people, this is what happened to us. People saw it firsthand. They saw their story. My next point, and we're almost going home. How do people see your story? The people that watch you. I'm not talking about the people that talk to you every day and they know that you're a little crazy, but they're forgiving because they're your friends, so they don't hold it against you that you cuss a little bit and you smoke a little bit and you do the CBD oil on the lower in the bathroom at work and they just let it slide. I'm not talking about those people that know you and love you. I'm talking about people that God assigned to you to watch and learn from you. People who your life is supposed to be a testimony to them. People who are supposed to be encouraged by you. How do they see your story? I want you to wrestle with this idea. How do they see me? They be rolling with me. I'll just be doing whatever, talking about whatever. I'm married, but I'll be talking about, look at her. Mm. And this is a young person watching me considering marriage, and I'm giving them this example of marriage. How do they see my story? How do they see my story? How do they see what we're going through, what we're dealing with? It's very interesting to me, you all, that the king said, the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, instead of saying God. When I was reading this story, it was interesting to me how he said, this is the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, but he never said God. You know, God is good. It's crazy because sometimes our stories don't have the expected end that we thought they would. And you still got to trust them anyway. I want to talk to some parents who got grown kids. Sometimes you're like, I did my best and my baby's still tripping. You still got to trust them. You're like, one of my friends think, well, if you parent right, your kids is going to be right. People that got kids know, nah, that's not always true. Because I did my best and they still a trip. Amen, somebody. I didn't never do that. And how you doing that? And I didn't do that. You must have got that from your daddy's side. Amen, somebody, right? And you still have to trust God even when they watch your story and they trip. Nebuchadnezzar's response is, thank God for the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Can I be honest with y'all? I preached kind of weird today, but I did it on purpose. I skipped some scriptures in the middle, but I did it on purpose. If y'all was paying attention, I was jumping. I was like, Nate, just give me 27, right? We was running. And the reason I did that is because I wanted you to notice something. I wanted you to notice their works, and I wanted you to notice their story. I wanted you to notice their story, their works, how people see our works and how they see our story. But what part did we skip? We skipped when they were in the fire. I want you to look with me at this last verse, and we're going to get out of here. Daniel, the third chapter, in the 24th verse. It says, then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet. This is in the middle. He was amazed and asked his advisors, weren't there three men that we tied up and threw into the fire? They replied, certainly, your majesty, we threw in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He said, look, I see four men walking around, unbound, unharmed, and the fourth looks like the Son of God. Please hear me. Don't be so caught up in what people see that you miss him. Don't be so caught up in how they see you and what your story, what your testimony is, and how you're trying to encourage people with how God brought you out, that you miss that God is with you in the middle. At the beginning of the story, we saw their works. At the end, we saw their testimony. And we read the story and we just blowing through it. God was with them and da 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 da. But you forget that God was there in the middle. I began talking about this. I told you all, our church closed and now we're open. And in the middle, I was feeling depressed. I was struggling. I had all this anxiety because I didn't know if it was over for us. I'm questioning, God, did you really call me to ministry? I'm trying to start this church, Papa Bill tried to get me to take this job at this big old church. I said, no, now my church can't open. And I'm like, what did I do? What did I get my family into? And people calling me on the phone and I'm embarrassed to tell them I don't know what's going on. But they saw we did a phenomenal job at the beginning of the pandemic and they see that we're open. And it's an amazing work what we did. It's an amazing story that we're open. But many of y'all don't really know that God was with me in the middle. In the middle. See, Juan is my friend. We see each other at the gym all the time. He say, what's going on with the church? I'm like, oh, you know, we come and pray for us. And he don't know in my mind, I'm crying on the inside. And I'm saying, Lord, I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. And as I was stressed, he began to give me peace in the middle. As I felt struggle, he began to give me peace in the middle. And many of us limit our Christianity to our works and to our stories. I give. I serve. I love. If somebody's at the gas station, oh, I'm giving them some money. We feeding the homeless, I'm there. What you need, Pastor? I got you. I got you. You meet somebody, oh yeah, God saved me. Girl, I was crazy, I was nasty, and he picked me up, he turned me around. Those are great works and a great story. But have you thought about where he is in the middle? Many of us limit our testimony to 20 years ago. I don't want to hear that God delivered you from crack. Crack went out in the 80s. Where are you right now? And where is he? I want to challenge you on this day to begin to see God in the middle of what you're going through. Because seeing is believing. And the only way your faith will be encouraged is if you see him and say, I don't love where I'm at, but I know he loves me. I don't feel good right now, but I have faith. I may not feel like loving my spouse, but God loved me when I was unlovable. So I'll love them. You gotta find him in the middle of what you're going through. You have to find him in the middle of where you are, because if you focus on your works and your story and lose focus on him, you'll find yourself floating further and further and further from him. It's funny that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego went into the fire. And a lot of people focus on the before and after. But I want to encourage you all, stay close to the fire. You got to stay close to the part where God is with you. That's the most important thing in this life. Where do I see God? I'm telling y'all, I was pastoring for 3 years now. And I realized a part of my pastorate, I don't know if I was giving you Jesus in the middle. I was giving you could do it and be encouraged and great faith and great things and God is a miracle worker. But you can have all that and miss him. You can have bigger, better, stronger, increase, expectation and miss him. And I don't want anyone that ever walks through these doors again to miss him. I want to encourage somebody today. If you feel like you have great works, if you feel like you have a great story, but if you're honest with yourself, you missed him. He's here for you. See, Jesus doesn't go anywhere. God doesn't go anywhere. We do. He doesn't leave. He doesn't move. His arms are wide open. And sometimes we walk away. And I want you to ask yourself in this moment, am I at a place in my life where I need to bring him back to the middle? Where I need to focus on where we are, him and I? If that's you in this moment, I want to pray for you. Listen, for a long time, my big sister Marquita, she would tell me, she'd say, Pastor Lance, sometimes it's like muzzling an ox. Sometimes you don't really allow God to move freely. And the truth is, I came from a Pentecostal charismatic expression that sometimes I feel like they went over the top. So I was like, we're not doing none of that. Because I don't want to offend nobody. I got Papa Bill, my big homie. I don't know if you know about that. So I don't want to push too hard. But what I want to do is invite you, if you're here today, I got to let God move freely. If you're here and you're saying he's not in the middle, I want you to meet me at this altar. We're going to pray for you. If you're here today and you're saying, Pastor Lance, I've been doing the works. I look the part. My social media is right. My friends know that I'm a Christian. But I haven't focused on him like I need to. I haven't met him in the middle. I want you to meet me at this altar. I'm not going to wait long, but never let God talk you, or never let the devil talk you out of what God is trying to talk you into. If you're at your seat and you're saying, I know that I need to engage him in the middle. Listen, there's somebody else that's sitting there, they're coming. Where you look the part. Some of us, we don't even look the part. You ain't even tried to look the part, but you want to put him in the middle. If that's you, this is your opportunity to see him again, to get closer to the fire. Listen, this is a moment for everybody at this altar. Of honesty, of transparency. God took the first step by loving you, but you took the next step by saying, God, I want to get right again. I want to be right where I'm supposed to be again. I want to make that choice to focus on you in the middle. And you can never go all in for God without him going all out for you. So what I want you to do while you're at this altar, I want you to lift your hands as a sign of surrender. And I want you to get your mind on those areas, those spaces and those places where you may have missed God, where you didn't allow him into those areas of your life, where you said, you know what, I got it under control. I can manage it. Think about those areas of your life. And right now I want you to invite him in. Lord, we welcome you into our family. Lord, we welcome you into the middle of our finances. Lord, we welcome you into those areas of frustration. Lord, we need you in the middle. Father, I'm praying for these people at the altar who were bold enough to say they want to get closer to the fire. Lord, it's not about our works. It's not about our stories. It's not even about us at all. But Father, it's about you. You're the fourth man. You're the way maker. You're the miracle worker, God. And we thank you that right now you are giving us a new strength. You are giving us a new joy. You are giving us a new strategy. What the devil meant for evil, God, you are turning around for our good. Lord, this day, August the 8th, 2021, will be a day we look back on and say, Lord, you changed everything. Lord, you did it again. Lord, you moved like never before, and we thank you for doing it. We thank you for being a God in the middle, Lord. We see you now, and seeing is believing. I want you, with your area of need, get that area on your mind. That area of struggle, get that area on your mind. That area of lack, get it on your mind. And I believe by faith, God is about to meet you there. God is about to move in that space. He's about to move in that area of your life. And you may have some struggles, you may have some things pull you back sometimes, but by faith, you will never be the same again. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank God and amen. You may go back to your seats. Listen, I don't believe that we should get together in spaces like this without offering an opportunity to come into a relationship with Jesus Christ. If you hear a word, you're encouraged by a word, you just lift some practical principles, I want to tell you that's not enough. You got to have a relationship with the God that we serve. Scripture says that he would leave the 99 to go after the one. And you may look around this room and say, I don't know if I fit in like everybody else. I don't know if I feel like everybody else. It says he would leave the crowd to go for the one. Many of us, you've been to church before. You've given your life to God before, but you're not where you're supposed to be. This is your repentance moment. You know, I have a car, and every so often a light on my dashboard comes up and it's telling me I need to take my car in for maintenance. My car is not broke, it's still working. It just says there's some things we gotta get right in order for things to keep going the right way. And that's what repentance is. It's just maintenance. You're saying, Lord, I'm not crazy. I just wanna say, forgive me again. Just make me right again. It's maintenance for your relationship. Some of you, this is your repentance moment. There's others who are like, you know what? I've completely turned my back on God. I've never truly given my life to him the way I should. Maybe this is my first experience really being open to what he has for my life. If that's you, this is your salvation moment. I can tell you, there's nothing like inviting Jesus into your life. There is nothing like inviting Jesus into your life. I trust God in every area of my life. I do, and I'm not saying I do it perfectly. Sometimes I struggle. Sometimes I'm like, Lord, is it you? Is it me? But I can tell you, my wife and I have been blessed because we trust him. There's some areas where I'm like, baby, I don't know how we did that. And this is just all God. I'm like, I don't know how we flowing, but it's God. Amen, somebody. I'm like, you know what? It's the Lord is doing, and it's marvelous in my eyes. So no matter where you find yourself, if this is your salvation moment, if this is your repentance moment, I want you all to pray this prayer with me. Will you lift your hands as a sign of surrender and repeat after me? Say, Lord, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I believe that you died on the cross and that you rose again on the third day. And when you got up, I got up. I thank you, Lord, for saving me, for taking me out of this and this out of me. And I'll never be the same another day in my life. I'm saved. Let's put our hands together for salvation. Listen, I say this almost every time we do an appeal for salvation, but there is a process to your progress. What that means is it doesn't happen overnight. Everything doesn't just change overnight. For some people, it may, but for most, it doesn't. For some people, they like, you know what, God took that away from me immediately. But some of us, it's a process. You got to put one foot in front of the other and one foot in front of the other. But you keep trusting him, and one day you'll say, wow, look how far he's brought me from. So you may wake up tomorrow with some of the same issues, some of the same wants and desires that you know you need to let go of, but you continue to trust God. Continue to spend some time in his word, in worship. Continue to come to church and watch how God will make the rest of your life the best of your life.
Let your light reflect on me. I promise I'm not hiding anything. It's water.
Flow through us, Jesus, heal the bruises. Jesus, clean the music. Jesus, please use us. Jesus, please help. Jesus, please heal. Jesus, please forgive. Jesus, please reveal. Jesus, give us strength. Jesus, make us well. Jesus, help us live. Jesus, give us wealth. Jesus is our safe. Jesus is our rock. Jesus, give us grace. Jesus, keep us safe.
Clean us like the rain in spring. Take the chlorine out of conversation. Let your light reflect on me. I promise I'm not hiding anything. It's water.